Compared with the United States, most of Europe has fared better in handling COVID and coming out of lockdown. And one country in particular has drawn a lot of attention by being something of an outlier. Sparsely populated Sweden did not order a lockdown or close its economy. At first, it looked like a successful gamble. But now that almost 6,000 people have died, much higher than any of its neighbors, it's raising questions, especially since the government also now fears that deaths could nearly double in the winter. So was staying open worth that loss of life? Sweden's top epidemiologist, Dr. Anders Tegnell, is behind the country's strategy and he's joining me now from Sweden. Welcome to the program, Dr. Tegnell. So let me first start by asking you to respond to that. You know, now you and the government are suggesting that there could be a doubling of the death count in the winter with the onset of the flu, etc. Do you still stand by the strategy that everybody, you know, termed outlier?
Yeah, well, I think that we still believe that this strategy has served us very, very well in many different aspects. I know that the death toll is very high. It's not extremely high if you compare us to countries like Belgium, Netherlands, or the UK, which are countries which in many ways have a much more similar epidemic than our neighboring Nordic countries, which are quite different in many ways when it comes to the epidemic.
Well, we do have those comparisons. So you're right that you are somewhere, you know, on the continuum under those countries, but above certain other countries. The fact of the matter is, though, I guess you could have done something different, couldn't you, to avoid that number of deaths? Because while you point out the difference between these countries compared to your immediate neighbors who took a completely different approach, your death toll is massively higher. Theirs is in the low hundreds at best.
Yes, but then you also need to realize that those countries are very different. They have a different kind of population structure. Their big cities is nowhere near the size of Stockholm, even if Stockholm is nowhere near the size of London. So I think a more fair comparison is really with the Netherlands and Belgium and countries like that. But even so, I mean, there is really no proof that the lockdown would have saved the people in the long-term care facilities in Sweden. We can see when we saw the problems in the long care facilities, we gave them a lot of advice, a lot of other agencies gave them a lot of advice. The number of cases in our long-term facilities fell very, very quickly, and we now have almost no cases in our long-term care facilities anymore, which shows that it's quite possible with the Swedish strategies still to protect the long-term care facilities and the people living there.
Okay, but you know what? That's interesting because you did also say when those terrible numbers out of the care, I mean, 50% of the deaths, if I'm not wrong, came from elderly care facilities. And you did say that certain things could have been handled better. Was that clearly one of the things that could be handled better?
Yeah, I think that we really need, and I'm sure we will, when this is all over, and already now we're doing a lot in that area, think about the quality of care in our long-term care facilities, seeing how that care, the security of these people can be improved, because we have shown already that the security can be improved vastly already just by falling back and following the guidelines that were already in place.
So what, I guess when you look at the future and when you predict that these deaths could double by the time of the flu pandemic, by the end of the year, what might you, I mean, you're saying you're not going to do anything necessarily differently. What do you think has sort of worked for you? And you talk about Sweden being different, and I'm going to get to that in a minute, but what's worked? I mean, relatively, you do have a high death toll compared to your neighbors. Relatively, I don't think you have immunity that you may have hoped to have had, even though you say herd immunity was not the strategy. And relatively speaking, you're going to get double the deaths, which you're predicting it by the end of the year. So what exactly went right?
No, but first of all, I mean, what we have now published is not predictions. What we have now published is different scenarios for our regions and communities to plan for the fall. And I think that's important to remember that. That means these are not projections. These are just numbers that they need for their planning. And we have said very clearly that the mortality rates we have not invested a lot of analysis in getting them right. What we have invested a lot of time in is getting the, when we will get new peaks and how those peaks will look so that the healthcare services can plan better for them. So we don't really believe that we're going to have a doubling of the death tolls, nowhere near it. And furthermore, as I said, we have now actually put the quality in place in the elderly care homes in such a good way that we now, in spite of the still circulating viruses, we have almost no cases in them anymore. And already now we see that the cases in Sweden are falling rapidly during the last few weeks. We have almost no introduction into ICUs anymore. We have very few serious cases coming along. And our death toll is down so that we have no excess mortality in Sweden anymore, which I think you need to look at, because the way we're recording mortality in Sweden is a lot more stringent than in most other countries, which means that when we look at the excess mortality and we look at the recorded cases of COVID-19, they're almost exactly the same in Sweden. In many other places, it's 50 to 100% higher. So it's also not completely fair to look at mortality rates at this stage. I think that's something we need to look at much further into the future. But coming back to
what about injury rates? And let me just ask you just a question, because yeah. I think everybody's sort of now getting more information about the damage that this can do, this virus can do, you know, even if you yeah. recover. You know, the long-haul damage, the damage to all sorts of vital organs, the damage to blood vessels and the rest, lung scarring. What are you learning about that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we really collected the data around that so far. But what I hear from my colleagues that works in intensive care is that they've become a lot better at treating these patients. The recovery rate becomes much higher these days. The time in ICU is also much shorter. So I think that is also something that we in Sweden, and I think also in many other countries, have been a lot better at. And hopefully that will also mean that the consequences, long-term consequences, will be a lot fewer for the people getting into ICUs mm-hmm. at this stage.
And finally, you're still not calling on Swedes to wear masks, just like the country did not call on any obligatory measures to be taken. A, why not on masks? And B, just explain briefly, finally, the nature of your relationship, the state with the people, and why this strategy worked was put into place in Sweden.
Let me start with that, because I think it's important to realize that our strategy in many ways have given the same effects as much of the lockdowns. We can look at the travel patterns in Sweden and in our Nordic neighbors, and the number of travels diminished just as much in Sweden as it did in other countries. In Sweden, our flu season stopped abruptly because our social distancing also gave an effect on the flu. And I've talked to, among others, on my British colleagues, and it seems like the effects of the voluntary lockdown that we instituted in Sweden in many ways were quite close to the legal lockdown instituted in other countries. So I think the difference is not as big as many people would like it. And we managed at that time keep schools open, which is incredibly important for public health in the country. We managed to, in many ways, keep the society more open, avoiding a lot of other negative effects on public health in Sweden. So I think in many ways, this has proven very successful. And we managed to do that with keeping the healthcare services in Sweden working with a very high level of quality. There was always free beds. There was never anybody with COVID-19 who was denied a treatment that they could benefit from. So I think that's important aspects to remember.
All right, Dr. Anders Tegnell, thank you for joining us from Sweden.